Welcome everyone. Thanks for joining us today's expert webinar. My name is Aaron Samuel. I'm from Spring People. Spring People is India's biggest corporate technology training company. And as a part of our expert webinar series, we are glad to have Ms. Chetna, Head L&D Global, Ericsson India. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type in the questions in the question box. And at the end of the session, Ms. Chetna will answer all the questions. And for now, over to Ms. Chetna.
Thanks, Arin. Hi, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, great. So first of all, thanks for joining in. I know it's, you know, taking out time from your busy schedule is always, you know, not so easy to do. So first of all, thanks for that. And just to confirm, are you able to see the slide that I have just put up? Is the slide yes. visible?
Yes, it was visible. Yes.
Okay, great.
Thanks.
Yeah, thanks. So I think I'll just get started. And the format which I would probably propose that we would use is that I will talk about two different aspects when it comes to this topic of managing learning in a VUCA world. One is from a perspective of the organization, the different people who are involved in working in a corporate, which is the employees, you know, business leaders, and so on. And the other perspective, which I'll also briefly touch upon towards the end, is from an L&D function perspective, because I understand that a lot of people attending the webinar might be from an L&D background, who are a part of the L&D team in their respective organizations. So maybe what I'll also try and do is I will share some thoughts, some insights into what is it that, in my opinion, what L&D team, how do they need to respond to, you know, this challenge of managing learning specifically in an environment that we are today living in. So I hope that plan should be okay with everybody. So with that, let's get started. VUCA is nothing but, you know, four different terminologies or four different words, which is volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. Now, why is it relevant or why is it important in today's world? We are all part of the corporate world where almost everything keeps changing on a regular basis. As they say, that change is the only constant in life. So be it the business plan that keep changing, which be it the priority that business wants us to focus on as an organization and hence as an L&D, which keeps changing, be it the market environment, which is so uncertain and so dynamic that that itself is a big force or a big factor because of which all the internal systems, processes, plans, structures would obviously need to change to respond to the uncertainty and the changing dynamics in the market. Complexity, because in today's world, the number of people involved in a single decision, unlike maybe 15, 20 years back, are much, much more number of people, be it in the sales process, be it in the delivery part of the organization, be it in the enabling function, what is the strategy, what's the response. Everything has become much more complex just because the business is changing at such a fast pace. And ambiguity, again, because nothing is spelled out in a very clear term. Whenever we start with any kind of a discussion with the business, even one of the things that always gets repeatedly mentioned is that this is a very high level understanding of what we have and what we need to do. And as we start doing the planning more in detail and later on the execution more in detail, a lot of things also keep changing. So there's a lot of ambiguity around what needs to be done, how it needs to be done, what is the right fit, what is the right timing to do anything, what is it that we are doing, how critical and important is it for the organization that we are doing it, because the goalpost, as they say, always keeps changing. So that, all those dynamics, all those different inputs, they make the entire environment in which we operate a complete VUCA world. And that's what the topic is, that if this is the reality of business today, we are living in an environment where things keep changing, business dynamics keeps changing, business priorities keeps changing. How do we as a function, how do we as a learning organization equip ourselves so that we are able to best meet this environment which is so dynamic and so ever-changing? So that's what we're going to be deliberating as we go along. A typical snapshot into what are we facing from the audience that we are typically going to be looking at from a learning perspective. So which is a modern learner. If you look at a modern learner, I'll just not talk about all the parts of the chart here, but typically to me, what is very important and strikes out is a learner would not be able to spend more than 1 minute, 1% of their work time on learning, which means 99% of what they would be doing in the time that they are working would be outside their learning. And let me kind of also put a rider there. Here, what we are talking about learning is more the formal modes of learning where they are getting into a classroom and learning. Because a lot of learning, the way I look at it, also comes from the other non-traditional sources of learning, be it on the job, be it peer learning, be it in the various interactions that we have. So we are here typically talking about that 1% of time, 1% when a learner is actually going through a proper formal learning, which will be organized by the learning function. A lot of other things are also being organized, which are maybe less formal or more informal, but we're not going to talk about that for the discussion here. And rest is something that, the rest of the boxes here you can kind of look at. At the same time, while we have a paucity of time, hence, where we are able to get the people, that is the people who need to undergo a structured learning for an extended amount of time. I know when I started my career almost 2 decades back, it was absolutely normal to plan trainings for a week at a stretch, which is 8 into 5, 40 hours of learning program was not a abnormal thing. It was quite a norm. In most of the knowledge organizations in IT, in telecom, in all the other such organizations, doing these training sessions for an extended period of time, 3 days, 5 days, and even longer, was kind of, a very common occurrence. I can't imagine today, that we can get a group of people at a mid-level or a senior level for that amount of time together. It's kind of next to impossible. So today, what people, employees, leaders, CEOs are looking at are interventions, learning interventions, which are flexible, which means they are not, they are not outside their work. It is a part of the work that they are doing. It's interwoven into their day-to-day activities and day-to-day work. There are different methodologies being used. There are different modes being used to impart training. Some is virtual, some is face-to-face, some is through maybe different channels, YouTube, Google, Udup. I mean, you have so many different platforms that are available today to do training. But having said that, while we need flexibility, we're also looking at trainings which are impactful, which means those trainings where the learner at the end of that learning intervention and the team to which this person goes back to is able to feel that, yes, that intervention was helpful, had an impact, was able to help this person do his or her job more effectively, right? So it has to be flexible, but without any compromise on what the person is learning from, that intervention has to be also impactful. While both these things happen, that means it is supposed to be flexible, it is also supposed to be impactful. I mentioned in the earlier part of my conversation that we are also looking at the same time trainings not in events. It's not an event learning, which is, it's not that you do training for 3 days and then there is lull for another 2 months and then you are put in another training program for another 2 to 3 hours and so on. What is expected is that the learning today has to be continuous. So learning is seen as something which will keep happening during the course of your work and even maybe off work, because nobody would have either the time available or even, I would say, even the attention span is so limited that getting the attention of a learner for an extended amount of time is also quite difficult. So you are looking at something through different mix and matches of modes of learning, duration of learning, ways of how you are reaching out to the learner community. All that is also evolving and changing as per the environment in which we are working. So the expectation is we are looking at training or learning interventions which are flexible, which are impactful, but at the same time, we are also looking at something which is continuously helping the organization to grow from a competence point of view. Okay. I think this is again similar to what I spoke about. We are looking at a new world altogether. The dynamics of business are changing, and obviously the response from the learning and the organization obviously has to be also different than what it was maybe a few years back. So it's just a reinforcement of the same message here. Here, what we are trying to look at is how are things today versus what is it that we are seeing as a trend? Some of it is no longer maybe future. It's already happening today. But definitely what we will be seeing is more of those trends happening in the next 3 to 5 years to maybe 10 years or so. For example, I'll not touch on all these aspects. Maybe I'll pick up one or two to drive the point here. For example, it is not so uncommon today to have the structure of an organization no longer hierarchical. Because today it is quite common to have a matrix organization, which means a person is mapped to one part of the organization, right? The reporting manager may be one sitting in one unit in the organization, whereas practically, the person, this employee, will be working with different stakeholders much more than the team, the home team to which this particular employee has been mapped. So it is more getting into a mode of projects, more of squads and teams, and more of shared services. And this is very, very common, at least I can see in the organization and the kind of industry that I am a part of, which is a technology, which is a telecom, which is an IT kind of a setup. Every employee, so employee now is seen more like a fungible resource. So you loan a fungible resource, you loan an employee depending upon his or her skill set and the demands of a particular project. So the project team is put together, which has a life only till the project is going on. Once the project is completed, the team gets disbanded. They go back to their home units. And when the new project comes up, another set of team gets identified, who work again as a team. So no more are we talking about a strict team which will be a static team, which will always, you know, be working together as a whole team, but it is more like a fluid team where people, you know, resources are getting added, people are moved out into different domains, into projects, into the various, you know, shared services requirement and so on and so forth. And obviously, that also has, you know, a impact on the kind of jobs and roles that people are currently involved in. So everything, I'll come back to the same point, which I said a couple of minutes back, that is the dynamics in which we are currently working. So jobs are changing, job titles and requirements are changing, the descriptions of our jobs are changing, which obviously means the skill sets that the people need to have today to do those given requirements, be it different projects, be it different teams that they are part of, are a little different, or I would say they're quite different than what are the kind of competence or the skill sets that were required of a team member who was a part of a particular team till the time the person was in that organization. So that today is no longer a reality. So we are seeing a lot of changes in there also. And of course, it has an impact on the way we work. It has an impact on the culture of the organization. Everything is kind of moving towards being more open, being more dynamic, being more ever-changing and ever, you know, requirement coming in and coming out depending upon the time and the assignment that the person is a part of at that point in time. I'll just quickly take a pause to see if there are any questions. No, I don't think there are any as of today, as of now. So please feel free to post your questions, though I may be answering some right now and some towards the end. But if you have any thoughts or questions or comments, please keep sharing them, as and when you have those questions coming to your mind. I hope I'm still audible and you are with me.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so what does that mean, for the organizations and as a whole for us? Which means we are shifting as a culture, as an industry from, we are shifting from an activity base to what is an impact that we are able to create, which means as an organization, how we learn, how people learn, how organizations learn is equally changing, because earlier, as I said, the roles that the people used to do were not changing ever so often. It was changing every few years. Maybe now that change is happening not in years, it is happening in months and probably in weeks, because the same individual has to be a part of one team today and maybe part of another team, or the requirements of the business are changing so fast that the skill set required, the competence required to respond to that challenge has to be seen in a very different perspective. That basically means that there is a lot of opportunity for all of us to look at things with a much better way in which we can collaborate with different teams, collaborate with different groups. It could be with business, it could be with the different stakeholders that we are interacting with, so that once you know in what direction your business is moving, once you know what is the expectation of business from you, from a learning standpoint, from a learning function standpoint, it is only then that you can come back with a framework or a solution which is more relevant to today's business reality. Otherwise, the tried and tested methods of what has been done, which might have worked earlier, may not be the best solution that will be working for today and maybe even for future. So you have to keep recalibrating, as I say. You have to recalibrate. You have to know what is happening, what direction is business taking, what direction is your market going, what are the realities with which you need to be, you know, prepared for, so that you are able to respond in a much better, in a much timely, and in a much, you know, fruitful way. Otherwise, you know, you may have the best of the experience or the know-how, but if it is not coupled with the reality in which we are working, somewhere there will be a disconnect and things will start falling apart. Now that we spoke a little about the business, the dynamics that are changing in the business and what is happening, you know, from that perspective, maybe we'll take some minutes, a few minutes to spend here on how is the learning as a, you know, as a group also changed in the last about 20 years or so. If you look at the chart on the left-hand side, which talks about the evolution of L&D, everything from the formats that were used in learning, from what were the systems that we were using in learning, everything you see has changed, I would say, drastically in the last 20 years. So anybody who's been around for at least 10 years, you know, working, would see some of these trends that they would have been a part of. So to start with, somewhere around 2000, 98, 2000, 2002 timeframe, the buzzword that time was e-learning and blended learning, where you had some part of learning being done through virtual mode, some part of learning being done through face-to-face or ILT or instructor-led learning. You know, and there was a lot of focus on creating content. So I remember I was part of many organizations where I would say 60, 70, or probably 80% of the L&D organization was busy in creating content, be it an e-learning content, be it a learning content for a particular classroom session and so on. So there was so much of focus and so much of time that was getting spent in simply creating content. There was the, from a system perspective, we were looking at an LMS that could host these e-learning modules. And hence we had a lot of focus on our vendors like Skillsoft and Saba and, you know, many other similar organizations who were able to help us in packaging these content that were at times created in-house. At times you were able to buy these contents directly from these vendors, like Skillsoft had their own content and so on. There were different other vendors who would provide you content. And you would simply be looking at an LMS which would help you host these, you know, these packages or these content modules onto the LMS, from where people or the employees would access it, and then that tracking and the reporting accordingly would happen. Then came a phase where, you know, we looked at LMS more from a talent platform perspective. Now, what does that mean? Which is, talent platform entailed much more than L&D. So you had learning in the LMS. You also had some part of performance management being tracked through it, and even other functions of HR also getting tied up into that one integrated system. And hence, that served more like a talent platform than simply a LMS where you only could host the e-learning modules. Then there was a lot of focus on creating learning paths or career tracks, right? Which was nothing but, we still have this as relevant. I mean, there are different terminologies being used in different organizations. You have a learning track. You have, you know, various other terminologies being used here, which actually gave you a kind of a structure as to what are the learning modules or the learning pathways or learning, you know, sequence that needs to be followed. It could be for a particular role. It could be for a particular group of people who are hired depending upon the experience and the organization that they ultimately are a part of. So that also started happening. Also towards the same time, which is around 2004, 2005, 2006, we also saw a lot of learning happening through the social means, which is your YouTube and, you know, the other new modes, because people started accessing that, and a lot of awareness around that happened. And hence, the learning function was also supposed to tie up some of those into the learning fabric of the organization. And hence, a focus around that was also emerging. Then we moved into a few years later, where there was a lot of buzz around, no, we will not look into a training calendar strictly, but we want to do something beyond that, which is basically continuous learning. So then we had this model of 70, 20, 10, which happened. So you were expected to spend a lot of time off the classroom also, but the learning would still need to happen. So as I spoke about, whether it is through peer learning, whether it is through the various interactions that an employee does during the course of their work. So the learning was not seen limited to what was being offered through the learning and development teams in the organization or through the classroom interventions only that were there. So people and organizations were encouraged to do learning on the go, as they call it, or learning continuously. So there was a lot of change in that dynamics as well. So on-demand learning started happening. Continuous learning started happening. So everybody was moving more towards, you know, how can we maximize the learning without having everybody going into classroom for extended period of time. So that was what we also saw happening towards this time. Last couple of years, what we are seeing more is while we are still focusing a lot on the continuous learning, but what has got added onto the whole gamut is the concept of where do we plug in a micro learning versus where do you plug in a macro learning. And I'll talk about this a little bit more in detail, maybe in another few minutes. Besides that, I'm sure many of you would have heard the buzzword of design thinking, right? Which is nothing but in a very simple term where we are talking about putting the employee or a customer in a broader way. For us, the customer in L&D are my employees. So putting the employee in the center of any plan that you build for learning. So what does the learner want? What is the business dynamics in which this learner operates? What are the various challenges this learner is faced with? And where does a competence plan fit into that so that the challenges with this person is, you know, needs to meet are better handled? So your entire planning focus dynamics of what a learner will be going through is by keeping this person or the employee in the center of this whole universe. So the entire solutioning happens keeping that reality in mind. His challenges, his business dynamics, his availability, because utilization today in almost all the organizations that I'm aware about is a big criteria. So you can't get people for learning for, as I said, extended hours. So you have to see, how do we steal, if I may call it, those hours from that employee's time and put him or her in a learning intervention, which is not very extensive, but is able to give just the right amount of information at the right amount of time so that the person is able to carry on with the deliverable in a much more seamless manner, in a much more effective manner, without having to dig a hole in terms of a time that the person has to spend, in terms of the budget that is required for the person to undergo those interventions. So those are the kind of things we are seeing today. And what is predicted, in a couple of more years is, intelligent learning, which is nothing but what we spoke about earlier. Learning now is moving more towards, how do we make the learning more personalized, which is what will work for, let us say, a fresh graduate in terms of the learning plan, the depth that is required, the number of things that this person needs to be taken through, will be a very different plan than somebody who is in the middle or senior level management. The kind of interventions, even the modes of learning may be different for each of these groups of people, because their maturity in the system, their understanding of the business, everything varies drastically. So your learning plan cannot be static. It will have to be personalized. It will have to be made keeping, as I said, the employee's reality of business and the dynamics in mind. Otherwise, you may propose something, it will still remain on the paper, but you may not be able to get the required traction from the audience or even the leader that you are trying to do it for, because those realities and your realities in which those solutions were being created or proposed may not be really talking to each other. So it's extremely important for you to personalize, you to kind of see where is it that this particular solution fits in. Does it really take care of the various aspects that as a learning function we need to be aware about? So all those things have to be taken care of, have to be kept in mind when from a learning perspective we are stitching together a learning solution here. And on the right hand side, just some pointers, which is more like an inference of what I just spoke about. We are looking at macro versus micro. We are looking at, there is a lot of impact because of the way we are hooked on to a Google or a Facebook. We are expecting a similar kind of a learning experience in what we see in our corporate world, which may not happen, but that is definitely a expectation the learners or the employees have. So a lot of organizations I'm aware about are moving to different systems because all those things like Facebook, like Netflix, those kind of experiences, intelligent, prodding, suggesting certain curriculums basis your digital footprint. There are new platforms that are coming up, which are called the Learning Experience Platform or LEPs. We're moving away from an LMS world to an LEP mode where the systems are intelligent enough or are expected to be intelligent enough to see what is the kind of interest that this person is showing from a learning point of view. And of course, there will be certain feeds that will be automatically coming depending upon which group you are mapped, what learning modules have been mapped to you, so on and so forth. Those are the kind of things that we are moving to. So gone are the days when you were looking at LMS purely as a platform where you needed to host your content and then the tracking would happen. So today, learning platforms are much, much more evolved, much, much more intelligent, and they are also helping you in kind of suggesting what are the kind of learnings that should be offered to a particular group of people. So we are kind of moving to a world of artificial intelligence. We are moving to a world of predictive, learning as to what is it that we should be suggesting to the learners and then pointing them to a direction which is in line with what the role of the person is, what are the kind of competencies that the person needs to be picking up along the course of the work that the person is doing. I'll again take a quick pause here to, I just have one question which is more like a comment, but any other thoughts, any other comments before I move on? Okay, so I'll probably take one question and then I'll try and come back for the other question a little later here. Priya is asking, in the intelligent learning system, what would be the parameters to weigh learning outcomes in a pragmatic fashion for behavioral indices like leadership development? Little out of scope for the topic that we are talking, but nonetheless, Priya. Learning outcome, or broadly speaking, maybe you might be referring to the ROI, the return of investment. It's a topic which has been deliberated quite a lot. In fact, it is a topic which I have spent quite a lot of time in. There are various ways, some very well-known, some maybe people evolve over a period of time and create their own mechanism of evaluating what are the learning outcomes. I think to me, I'll just highlight two things because this is another topic altogether. I think any learning intervention, be it behavioral, be it leadership, be it anything, the starting point or a starting successful intervention starts with how well has the learning intervention outcome been articulated, which means whoever is asking for a particular learning intervention, normally it's somebody from the business, do they understand or do they have a clarity on what do they want from this particular learning intervention? If that is spelled out, and that is where the learning consultant or the learning team has a very important role to play. If we are able to articulate or we have the business articulate what is it that we are looking at from a particular learning intervention, then mapping the learning outcomes against those expectations becomes much easier. Because you know what are you trying to achieve through. See, to me, a learning program is a tool. It's a medium. But what should that medium deliver has to be spelled out. And it cannot be spelled out by L&D. It has to be spelled out by the stakeholder for whom this program is being tailored. But L&D definitely has a role to play in nudging or cajoling these people to think through that. If that is done properly, I think half of your battle is won. Then you simply, from an L&D standpoint, have to make the expectation map to the outcome, and hopefully your content, your program design, all those things will work towards making that happen. And I think I can maybe spend some more time on it offline if you know it needs a further discussion. So I'll, in the interest of time, be moving to the next slide. Just a thought here that, you know, I think any change is to me a welcome change. It's a matter of how well are we prepared to manage that change and how much do we expect things to move in the direction, and are we really ready with the plan, with the thought process, with the mindset to manage that change. So coming to the crux of what we are looking at. Now that we know the realities, now that we know what has changed from a business standpoint, what has changed from a learning environment standpoint, some of the things from my experience, you know, what should be done to manage this entire gamut of VUCA. And I think we spoke about this a little in bits and pieces here. A lot of focus today, in my opinion, has to be from taking the content as is, but making it more personal, making it more curated. What does that mean? You may have the same content which may be relevant to five different audience groups. But I think what is important is that for each of the groups, you need to see what part of this content should be modified. It could be only 10% that you need to do. Are you able to add the relevant examples? Are you able to add the relevant case studies to it? Are you able to add the relevant experiences to it so that this content becomes more my content, which I am as an audience able to relate to? If it is too generic, if it is too something which I cannot relate with, my sense is that people will feel very disengaged from the learning or from what you are trying to do or arrive or achieve through your learning. So I think a good amount of time from L&D perspective that needs to be spent is on curating the right content for the audience that you are, you know, doing it for, and then to some extent personalizing it. I know it's not always possible in larger organizations to do it, but whatever you can, whatever is feasible, I think it's worth putting in that kind of an effort. Digital, flexible, social learning, I think we did speak about it a little. I strongly believe that your plan, your competence plan has to be flexible. It cannot be one size fit all kind of a plan, because your business plan, your business dynamics are changing. So what you might have thought of as a perfect plan 6 months earlier may no longer be perfect today because your business has moved 6 months ahead. So you need to recalibrate continuously so that your plan, your proposal has a relevance today when it is being rolled out, not the relevance it had when it was being planned to be rolled out. Because there is always a time lag between when it was planned and when it is rolled out. And the larger the time that has elapsed between the two, the planning and the execution, more requirement for it to be recalibrated, and whatever tweaks that are required to be done need to be done. Otherwise, you will have a plan which may not be the best plan fitting the current realities, and hence the acceptance would not be very high. Agility. Agility here is not only with respect to the people. I mean, everybody, the stakeholders, the business, the L&D team, the organization, as well as the processes. Because what may be relevant at a particular point in time may or may not be as relevant today. So from a people, practices, processes point of view, it's extremely important, particularly in today's date and time, to again take a stock of, is this, from a policy perspective, you may have a particular learning policy. For example, I'll talk about some of the organizations where I was a part of. It was very common, in a few years back to have a learning policy, at least in where I belong to, where it was said that every employee should do, let's say, 40 hours of training a year. Now, that may be important, relevant, required at that point in time, but I don't know if that can even be practically done today, because for certain groups of people, you may not require 40, you may require 400 hours of training. But there are certain other groups of people where just 3 hours, 10 hours of training may be good enough. So you have to recalibrate what are your processes, what are your policies around it, who are the people who are involved, and keeping it as relevant, as current, as much as possible. Otherwise, you will be talking of something which was like history, may or may not have that kind of a relevance and importance as we speak today. The other one is, while I see every organization, be it the learning team, be it business, be it everything, we are mostly focusing on what is required here and now, which are the current skills, which are the current competencies. A very less amount of time, generally, in my experience, gets spent on how do we look at things that would be required, maybe not today, but maybe 1 year to 3 years down the line. Because why it is important is that if you do not keep one eye on what is required in the future, you may actually land up in that time and not have enough time or enough planning and enough bandwidth to help you do that. So what ultimately will happen is you are always doing firefighting. You're always in a firefighting mode where you are rushing against time. You don't have the required bandwidth. You don't have the required resources. You don't probably even have the required insight to do a good job. So I would always suggest do an 80-20. So 80% of the time, or probably even 70% of the time, has to be spent on the today's or current competencies, both from a business perspective or even from an L&D perspective. But the remaining 20 or 30% of the time, I probably strongly suggest has to be on, can I take a slightly longer view of the competence? Can I take a slightly longer view of what are the kind of skills that may be required 1 year down the line, 2 years down the line, and at least start doing the initial groundwork of how do we prepare for those skills? Who are the audiences who need to go through them? what are the broad modalities of what needs to be covered there, so on and so forth. So that when you actually hit that time, your 50, 60% of things are already in place. You just have to plug in those balance pieces and you are good to go. So time-wise, you are good. Quality-wise, you should be able to do a good job. And all these things kind of help you make a better credibility for yourself within an organization which is so complex and which is so dynamic. The other thing is, keeping a focus on the key competencies. Now, why I am highlighting this specifically is because in today's day and time, it is extremely important to prioritize things because you will not be ever able to do anything and everything that is required to be done from you. Right? So you have to, as an organization, whether it's a learning organization, whether it is your business, you have to ask categorically, while these are my 15 things that I need to do, but which are the top 4 or 5, not more than that, which are the top 4 or 5 areas which you see as absolutely critical or must do? So that from a prioritization perspective, you are able to spend maximum amount of time in building those critical competencies, while the others take a slightly lower priority only when you have more bandwidth and you have more resources available. You may be able to focus on the others, because otherwise, if you do not have a prioritization defined, I don't think it is possible for you to focus on everything and anything and do a good job. You may be able to make people happy, but I don't know how effective and impactful you will be able to be. And of course, the other side of the coin, what is it that, in my opinion, need not or should not be a focus? We spoke about it. One size fits all, definitely a no-no. Permanent solutions, I don't think we live in an age where anything is permanent, so even your solutions cannot be permanent. You cannot bank on past trends and so on. So I think most of these we have elaborated, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time here. I'll move on to the, I think, the last 1 or 2 slides that are left. So if I were to summarize what we are talking about and what are some of the things from a response point of view we can look into, what is a toolkit that I can propose to manage each of these things, for example, volatility, you have to be more proactive. You have to forecast what is happening. You have to predict, looking into the future as to where does your business is going, and hence, able to forecast some of that. And you, of course, have to be flexible. You have to gather as much information as you can so that what you are planning is in line with what your information tells you. You have to be analyzing what you are getting information on, and then make your own SWOT chart as to what is the strength we have, how prepared are we, what are the opportunities, and what are the areas where we see gaps which needs to be plugged in. I didn't talk about innovation, but in my opinion, you have to be innovative. Your solutions have to be innovative. You have to go ahead and do new things. Some of them will work, some of them may not work, but I think if you do not do new things, you will be stuck in a rut and you will never be effective and impactful. So I am a strong believer of looking at innovation as a very important tool here. Specialization, to me, it's very important, because if you don't understand your domain, if you don't understand what area you are into and what you need to focus on because things are so complex, you will always be, kind of drifting from one place to the other and not able to give something which is meaningful back. So I think that's important. And of course, speed, impact, risk, all these things are quite critical. I'll just take another 3-4 minutes and then I'll open it for question and answers. I spoke about micro versus macro learning. So basically, in an employee's work life cycle, we when we join an organization, for example, as a fresher from the college, there are a lot of things which we need to learn and in a lot of depth. So that is where your macro learning comes into the picture, which means you need a deep insight, You need a long time that you need to spend on learning different things. So it is an in-depth learning. It is a longer learning. It is a learning when you are typically picking up something new or something which you are not very familiar with. So those are the things that you would be doing in a macro learning. Whereas most of the time, once you are into the system for a couple of years, what you may be needing most of the time is not macro, but maybe a micro learning, which is a short burst of learning only on certain things or topics which are relevant to you here and now, where you do not have enough expertise, but you just need a little bit of insight into a particular aspect. And that is where a micro learning comes in. It could be done through a video, through certain small tools, through an article, through a blog, through a website that has a specialized content on something, so on and so forth. So just a very, very broad level. Why I'm highlighting this micro and macro is it is important to know the difference, and more importantly, know which tool to use where for your learning to be impactful, for your learning to be personalized. Because you can't have only micro learning or you can't have only macro learning as a part of your toolkit. You have to have both. But in what proportion you use which one depends upon the audience, depends upon their maturity levels, depends upon their experience levels, and a lot of other factors. So, but you need to know what is available in your arsenal and which one to use where, so that you are able to get the desired outcome at the end of the intervention. And I'm not going to maybe skip on this tool. The last one is, this is specifically my recommendation for people who are part of the learning team. I think it's very important for us to practice what we preach. And this is a set of skills that I feel from a future 2018, 2019, 2020 perspective, next 2 to 3 years, anybody and everybody who is associated with L&D as an organization, L&D as a group, has to have in their kitty. I don't think it needs more elaborate explanation, be it around analytics, learning analytics specifically, be it around knowing the market trends or insight, be it around good performance consulting, which basically starts with knowing your business inside out. You have to know what is happening in the business. You have to know what is the trend happening, what are the challenges, what is the roadmap, so that then you, when you respond with your solution, this solution and the problem statement talk to each other, right? So I think I'll kind of leave it at that. And of course, a new definition of VUCA is a vision for volatility, understanding for uncertainty, clarity for complexity, and agility for ambiguity. So I think if we replace those with these, we would be in a much more prepared world and able to handle all these things, I think, much more effectively. And I will now take some questions. So Lokesh, your question is, please elaborate on L&D opportunity to close the gaps among technology, individual, business, society, government as an ecosystem. I think the last slide, what I just showed right now, probably partially answers that question. When I talk about the ecosystem, in my opinion, sorry, not the last slide, maybe the second last slide, which is practice what you preach. I think it's very, very important for L&D as a group of consultants, to know what are they doing. Because if they know what is their specialization, if they know what is the business moving towards, what are the business realities, what are the business challenges, what are the business dynamics, and then accordingly come back with solutions or recommendations which are more in line with those inputs that they have received. You could use technology as an enabler. You could use business inputs as an enabler. But at the end of it, what stitches all these together is your domain expertise and your performance consulting skills. If that is being done properly, I don't think it is so much of a challenge, but the challenge is how well prepared as a group, as an L&D team are we? Because normally, in my experience, L&D team generally goes to the business, asks what are your needs, notes down those needs, and then comes back and makes those, you know, executes those trainings. I think the role of L&D has to be much beyond taking the needs and executing those needs. It has to be two steps back. It has to be connecting what is the problem statement with the proposed solution and ensuring that these two talk to each other. The solution talks to the problem and we are able to show that value back to my stakeholder to say, this is what we wanted to do in the business first place, which is your outcome. So if that outcome, as I said earlier, of the intervention has been spelled out and articulated well, and you have rolled out a solution, your job is to actually tie the threads together to say, this was the solution that we proposed. This was the outcome that was expected from the learning intervention. This is how this solution will be and has been able to work on that problem statement. You may not be able to completely map the complete problem statement, but even if you are able to do part of that and then work towards the remaining part of it, I think it's a good start and that can be built upon as we go along. Hope I've been able to answer some of the questions that we, I've seen here. I don't know whether we have time, but maybe Abhishek, I'll take this last question. Where does TNA stand in case where ops or technology has to share the inputs? I frankly didn't really understand the question too much. I don't know, maybe you can rephrase the question so that I can attempt answering that. I think that's it from my side. Hope you had a session that you picked up something from, you had some learning from whatever we spoke. And please feel free to reach out to me on my LinkedIn, we can continue some of these conversations as we go along. Thank you very much.
Thanks, ma'am. Great. Thanks, everybody. We appreciate you being here. We will share the recordings end of tomorrow. And please visit springpeople.com for upcoming webinars and conclaves. Thanks again for joining us today, and we will see you next time soon.